Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church.
No.
And neither affiliated with a church or religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kenley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Now, since that time, we have established grand schools throughout the United States and various parts of the world. The Ontario Grand School was established in May of 1988. This time, I'd like to introduce you to school officials. Our president is Dr. Reginald Thomas. Now, at this school, we use and teach by the true and original name and title for Heavenly Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word of Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by Lord, by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lord's men and God's men. We now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, or the Latin language have any characters or letters in the alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Now, Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized on this chart as a cloud, in his pure spirit state as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We've drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word of Son. A super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. And this shape and form could only be seen in the divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Now later on, this self-same spirit manifests himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah. The world calls him Jesus Christ. There's only one name given up salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach by divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. And after Yahweh Elohim led the children of Israel up out of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him
a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. Now this pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. Also in the school, we go forth to prove that everything in the universe moves and operates according to the structure and the function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes this pattern. Now, the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this tutor as follows. Number one is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as He really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, modern practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. We have a prayer tonight by Dr. Salas. Our scripture lesson will be Romans 21st chapter. Our scripture reader will be Dr. Reginald Thomas. Thank you, Dr. Samuel.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for all the blessings you give it to us. The best blessing you ever give us to know some of your purpose and your plan and know this teaching. So it's the greatest gift man ever have. It's wonderful, and keep put your spirit in us, the wisdom, knowledge, understanding. That way we can keep going in life. I say all those things in your only sign name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say.
Thank you.
All right.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
I'll be reading Revelations, the 21st chapter from the Holy Name Bible. Critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by an Italian Jew, A.B. Trainer, and republished by Yahshua Promotions. Revelations, the 21st chapter on page 343. And they saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from Yahweh out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of Yahweh is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and Yahweh himself shall be with them, and he will be their Lord. And Yahweh shall wipe away all the tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am the first and the last, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountains of the waters of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his Lord, and he shall be my son. But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. And there came unto me one of seven angels which had the seven vials full of the seven last plagues and talked with me, saying, Come hither, I will show thee the bride, the Lamb's wife. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me the great city, holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from Yahweh, having the glory of Yahweh, and her light was like unto a stone which was a stone most precious, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystal. And had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates, at the gates 12 angels, and the name thereupon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. On the east 3 gates, on the north 3 gates, and on the south 3 gates, and on the west 3 gates. And the walls, and the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the names of 12 apostles of the Lamb. And he that talked with me had a golden reed to measure the city, and the gates thereof, and the wall thereof. And the city length 4 square, and the length is as large as the breadth. And he measured the city with the reed, 12,000 furlongs. The length and the breadth and the height of it are equal. And he measured the wall thereof, 144 cubits, according to the measure of a man, that is, of the angel. And the building of the wall of it was jasper, and the city was pure gold, like an under clear glass. And the foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stone. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third was a the fourth was an emerald, the fifth a sardis, the sixth sardis, the seventh a chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth a topaz, the tenth a chrysolite, the 11th, the 12th an amster. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Every several gate was of one pearl, and the street of the city was pure gold, as it were transparent glass. And I saw no temple there, for Yahweh El Shaddai and the Lamb are the temple of it. And the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon, to shine in it, for the glory of Yahweh did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof. And the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light of it, and the kings of the earth do bring their glory and honor unto it. And the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day, for there shall be no night there. And they shall bring the glory and honor of the nations into it. And there shall in no wise enter into it anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abominations or maketh a liar, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. I have read Revelations, the 21st chapter. That's all I'll say.
Hallelujah. Thank you. Okay, today's our workshop night. But some of the brethren are on their way to Chicago for the convention out there, and so this is what we have. But it's good to come to class. It's always good to come to class, you know, because we always expect to learn something, no matter what. Okay.
That's right.
So our first speaker tonight will be Dr. Hemza Pelotea.
Did I hear you say people said a convention?
Yeah, they have a
seminar.
A seminar.
Or just for the classes?
Yeah, they're like Will and Kennaway, also.
LeBron and that new lady.
Yeah.
And Joe and his son is going Friday.
They'll be going on the weekend.
So how many days is it?
I think just for the weekend.
Weekend.
Oh, just for the weekend?
Saturday, Sunday.
Oh, okay.
And they'll be back.
Oh, okay.
Blessings and good evening.
Amen.
And all praise to King Yahshua, which is a teacher in this beloved school, the Holy Spirit. What you see pictorially illustrated in front of you is a result of a divine vision and revelation that was given to the founder, Henry C. McKinley, in the year 1931 on Saturday, June 6, 9 o'clock in the morning. Number 12 and 6, please. Ready? Numbers 12 and 6. Are you reading?
Romans 12 and 6?
Numbers 12 and 6.
Oh, Numbers.
Yeah. See, because we come to find out that in John 4th chapter, that Yahweh's spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. And these are good words to meditate on in yourself. Mm-hmm. You understand? Because this thing comes by revelation.
Right.
It does not come by you looking at it and say, oh, read that, that's what it is. You can't read up on it or nothing like that. If Yahweh don't reach down and touch your heart and mind, you will never understand it. Mm-hmm. He must show you for yourself. That's why over there in Romans 14 chapter tells you that each man must be fully persuaded in his own heart.
Right.
So you want to know this thing for the surety. Now what was read in our scripture reading proves what Dr. Kennedy said John was out here on the Isle of Patmos receiving. Mm-hmm. He was receiving a divine vision and revelation, and what he did, he had to confirm Moses.
Mm-hmm.
He was looking back at the children of Israel. Read. Start. 23.
Numbers 12 and 6.
12 and 6 verse, yeah.
And he said, hear now my words.
Now who said that? That's Yahweh Elohim, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's saying, hear now my words, read.
If there be a prophet among you, I, Yahweh, will make myself known unto him in a vision and will speak unto him in a dream.
Why? Because Yahweh is spirit.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. So the way you see him, Yahweh Elohim, is only in a divine vision and a revelation,
mm-hmm.
not just a vision. Because these folks here came up on this mountain with them too, and they saw that.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
But they were, nothing was revealed to them in the sense that they came back down here and up came the golden calf. Mm-hmm. Revelation 21st chapter.
Revelations?
Yes, sir. I've been very, very, very sick, and on top of that, I've been very, very upset with me. I'm just now asking Yahweh to let it go, because when I started seeing my own, not yours, my own faults,
mm-hmm.
you understand? He used me to through you. Everything that I was pointing out that somebody else was doing, why would it bother me?
Mm-hmm.
Unless I did it.
Mm-hmm.
See, so what I'm doing is projecting my concepts into another person. And that's what we do in this school. We preach more gossip than gospel.
Yeah.
And we need this gospel, that's why I come here. Because you can at least hear the gospel. And then go on home and go about your business.
That's
you know,
right.
And can't nobody has an excuse. Because all these witnesses we got in this class, you don't have an excuse. Now, the first thing he says, to help you. See, that's why explaining that so-called you is important.
Yeah.
Because the first thing says to help you.
That's right.
Help who? Help you find and know Yahweh. That what the first thing is? Mm-hmm. Well, who do you think he's talking about?
Yeah.
You know, we got to be careful before we run our mouth, and we do.
Mm-hmm.
We do. I'm speaking of Himsa. Mm-hmm. So don't go out there and say, well, he said you. No, let's, I don't like that stuff. No, it ain't worth it. Read, Reggie, please.
Revelations, the 21st chapter. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth.
Now, this is John. Mm-hmm. On the Isle of Patmos, receiving this vision. Now, remember, John is the last of them.
That's right.
Last of the apostles and disciples. Is that right?
That's right.
He's the last of the Mohegans.
That's right.
He starts writing in AD 96, around there. Mm-hmm. Well, he starts writing. Okay? Now, he's writing in his revelation, confirming Moses on this end. Read.
And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth will pass away.
Listen to what he said. He said the first heaven, now according to the pattern, there's three compartments, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Most holy place, the holy place, and the court round about. That was shown to Moses on the mountain. He built one exactly like it in the wilderness. Okay? We also know that, give me, hold your finger to Reggie and get 2 Corinthians, I believe it's 12.
Second Corinthians 12 and 1. It is not expedient for me doubtless to glory. I will come to visions and revelations of Yahweh.
Now, that's the Apostle Paul, mm-hmm. who didn't know nothing about a vision and revelation mm-hmm. until it was time, until his thing was going to be in season for what he had to do, because he wasn't raised with the disciples.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. You know, he was a eunuch, and he was a Pharisee of Pharisees, mm-hmm. you know, and his job was to go put in jail, kill and capture those that preach Yahshua Messiah. Okay? Read.
And I knew a man in the Messiah more than 14 years ago.
Read.
Whether in the body I cannot tell, or whether out of the body I cannot tell. Yahweh knows.
Read.
Such a one caught up to the third.
Okay,
heaven.
See, now this, now we put that on the pattern. This is the third heaven.
Right.
Okay? Mm-hmm. So, as it's been brought out on many occasions, if there's the third heaven, there has to be a second heaven and a first heaven.
That's right.
Okay? Now, John in Revelation just said, for the first heaven, read that again, Red.
Revelation.
Revelation 21. Yeah.
And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from Yahweh out of heaven.
Hold it. Yeah.
Prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
Okay, now John said the first heaven. And the first earth was what?
Passed away.
Look, that's why it's painted black down there also. Mm-hmm. Because it was tore up from the flow up, if I could put it that way, mm-hmm. when Yahweh Elohim did what he was doing, finished doing.
Yeah.
There was no more sea. They had already went through the Red Sea, so they're out there in the wilderness. Right?
That's right.
And that's what John said. And then he saw what? Red?
And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from Yahweh out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
Read.
And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold,
the tabernacle.
Behold, the tabernacle of Yahweh is with men.
You see how it follows the pattern?
Mm-hmm.
It all goes by the pattern, and it's going to end up going right into heaven, mm-hmm. Canaan land.
That's right.
You understand? Mm-hmm. So, what's on my mind tonight is dealing with that and how Yahweh individually works for each and every one of us.
Right.
If you pay attention to you, see, I didn't understand the sicknesses and the couldn't walk and stuff, and I had to stay in the house for 2 months and all that. I couldn't understand that. But that's what it took for him to get me to check me out and start looking at me instead of Albert. Because it's easy. You know, it's just like, for example, the folks in Los Angeles that believe that that's their savior, Henry Clifford Kenny. They just doing their part. They're playing their part.
Yeah.
They got the I can't help it. I'm not mad at them. That could have been me. But thanks be to Yahweh, he let me know that though this outward man will perish, the inward man is renewed day by day. Mm-hmm. And that's what I am thankful. That's what I focus on. Because, see, we walk around so easily talking about these attributes.
Yeah.
And then all you got to do individually, so
is watch what an individual manifests. You'll see how enlightened he is, mm-hmm. or she is. For instance, we use this one, love. It's easy to say it. This is love, baby, right here. This is real love.
Yeah.
No greater love does a man have than do what?
Lay down his life.
For his friend.
That's right.
You understand?
Mm-hmm.
And you do it whether you know it or not. We all do it.
Yeah.
Yahweh used me in this example of a dope fiend, pimp, fool, lie. He used that's me laying down my life. To let you know how powerful Yahshua Messiah worketh in me. It's him that do this. Or else my brother be out there OD somewhere.
That's right.
That's how serious this thing is. And we you learn not to judge a book by the cover. Oh, she's so sweet. She would never do it. She did. You know, and all that kind of stuff. Or he did. Mm-hmm. This is an inward job. 2 Corinthians 13:5.
2 Corinthians. 13:5?
Yes.
2 Corinthians 13:5. Examine yourself whether you be in the faith.
Examine yourself whether you be in the faith.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
Prove your own self.
Look at you, prove your own doggone self.
That's right.
It's not your job to sit up and dispense judgment on each other or anybody in this world. They are playing their parts. Now, see, people have a lot of hard time with this. But it's simple. I was sharing it with Dolores tonight. When Moses got called up on this mountain, and he was given a vision of the creation, which is the first 5 books, remember, he got a rerun.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. So he saw his birth,
right,
his life and his death.
Mm-hmm.
That's all in there, because he don't come into the 3rd chapter or 2nd chapter when he comes into Exodus.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is that if it's a rerun, it's already over.
Yeah.
And he's showing them a rerun how it went.
Mm-hmm.
And we are in that original thing, but we're just, Dr. Kinley put it this way, I got to get this lecture and bring it in. It's also in the textbook that Yahweh is running the show all the way down to the meanderings of the carnal mind.
Mm-hmm.
He said if he didn't put it in us to do his will, we wouldn't do it.
Right.
Because that's what Romans 8 chapter is about.
Yeah.
It's all about that. In fact, get it, 8 and 6. Mm-hmm. Romans 8 and 6.
Yeah.
Romans 8. Yeah. I want to read it so get a witness. You must be fully
carnal minded.
Man, I'm telling you, we are so blessed. It just. Dr. Kinney made a statement that it's easy as 1, 2, 3, and right away I want to make it complicated. And then what do you think he means when he says, all tongues shall confess and all knees shall bow?
Yes, sir.
You don't think that's going to happen? It's happening right now.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, man, I sit up and cry like a baby sometimes when I think about what he has given us. I don't get mad. He took away that getting mad and stuff. You know, and trying to wait for a person like a damn, you know those vultures, they wait for somebody to die?
Yeah.
You come in class, you wait for somebody to make a mistake so you can show how smart you are and all this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, always looking for faults in somebody. I did that. It's bull. I'm just telling you right now, and if you don't want to take heed to the words that come out, that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
I used to try to get up here and have them lengthy, long, brought out lectures. I did that, but that was me doing it, or thinking I was doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Now I just say what he has to, for me to say and sit my butt down. Mm-hmm. It's just that simple. I don't care how nobody feels about me anymore. He loves me.
Mm-hmm.
That's all that matters. And his love is, as we go step into this over here, we get ready to step into it, bam.
Yeah.
Soon come. Read.
Romans 8 and 6. For to be carnally minded is death.
Now listen to this. To be carnally minded. Look at, when a carnal minded person is carnal, they're not conscious of them being carnal.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
You go try to tell somebody that in the church they're carnal. And don't try to tell somebody in this class they aren't. I'm talking about the IDMR. Mm-hmm. But they are. Strong delusion makes you believe a lie.
That's right.
Been there. Read.
For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace.
To be spiritually minded is life and peace. Remember, our slogan is speak the truth, and our watchword is peace. Mm-hmm. The only way you're going to get peace is when you start living the slogan.
That's right.
It tells you right there in the slogan, speak the truth to every man,
yeah.
Not some men. It's not hard, people. I was a liar of liars, a hustler of hustlers. I know. I made everything complicated. Made people hate me and all this other kind of stuff. Telling the truth, when I found out what it meant in this school has given me everything I have today for this last however many years. And I'm telling you, these attributes are not physically literally. You can't go buy a bucket of wisdom. You can't go buy a bag full of knowledge. You can't do that. You can't go buy a half a gross of love. Mm-hmm. They're spiritual. We know a natural state of it. Now we're learning the spiritual part of it. I just want to explode in him, you know? Sometimes I just say, man, another day out here. Father, when you gonna take it home? You know, and he tells me the same thing he told Paul. You know, grace is sufficient. What you got is what you get. You know, be patient, my son. Read.
Because the carnal mind is at enmity against Yahweh. For it is not subject to the law of Yahweh, neither indeed can it be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please Yahweh. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. If so be the spirit of Yahweh dwelleth in you. Now if any man have not the spirit of the Messiah, he is none of his. And if the Messiah be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is alive because of righteousness.
Read.
But if the spirit of him that raised up Yahshua from the dead dwelleth in you, he that raised up Yahshua from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you.
Hold it right there and go to Ezekiel 36 chapter.
Ezekiel?
Yes, sir. Go down there about 36 and 30. Start at 24. Yeah. Now this is a prophecy. Mm-hmm. This was a prophecy of Ezekiel. You know, I keep noticing now even more and more how Yahweh put his name or his title in him. You know, Elijah.
Yeah.
And Ezekiel and all, you know, and people in the world don't know these little things that we take for granted because we don't hurt them so much. They don't know this. It's the power to raise one from the dead. I'm not talking about like Lazarus.
Right.
I'm talking about spiritually and psychologically.
Right.
To never die again. I want that. I need that. Read.
Ezekiel 36:24.
Yeah.
For I will take you from among the heathen.
Now, did he take every one of us from the heathen? Even ourselves, which was heathen?
That's right.
He took us away from the heathen. Read.
For I will take you from among the heathen and gather you out of all countries and will bring you into your own land.
Now, he took my spiritually your own land, just like Canaan land was that in type.
Yeah.
We're talking about spiritual here, and we got a classroom. Well, we can come and learn in abundance Tuesday, Friday, Sunday. You understand? Tuesday, Friday, Sunday. We can go visit other schools, the ones that let us come visit. You know? But we have all this abundance. You can call on the phone and talk to somebody about this. You can have a cottage meeting at your own house and talk about this. You know? We don't have no excuse.
Right.
We really don't have an excuse. Read.
Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and ye shall be clean. From all your filthiness and from all your idols will I cleanse you.
Now listen, this is a prophecy, but it's got to happen in the day. Mm-hmm. And what's that day? The day of his death, after the death, burial, resurrection, ascension, and outpouring of the Holy Spirit. That's when that's when all this takes place. After, but Yahshua must die, bury, resurrect in you.
That's right.
Right? Read.
And a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you.
Now see, people take that statement, a new spirit will I put in you, they take it physically. They really do. Mm-hmm. After we get Satan out of you, mm-hmm. then we're going to put a Yahweh Elohim in you, mm-hmm. and all that kind of stuff. Read.
And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh.
Instantaneously. Read.
And I will give you a heart of flesh.
Read.
And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes.
And cause you. See, that's him in you, causing you. Now, you might think because you smoke a cigarette or you smoked a joint or something like that, that you ain't walking in. He ain't did it for that. He did not get up on this cross up here for your habits.
Right.
You understand? He didn't get up there because you smoke cigarettes and you don't. You drink liquor and you don't. He did not die for that.
That's right.
Especially when he knew right then that, hey, you take out the flesh and you'll see what I'm talking about. Because without the flesh, there ain't no need for all those habits.
That's right.
Read.
And ye shall keep my judgments and do them.
Now drop down there where it says, then you will remember.
Then shall you remember
listen to this. Now this is
your own evil ways.
This is after the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Then you will remember Ahimsa's old evil ways. That what it say?
No, your own evil ways.
Mm-hmm. Read.
Then shall you remember your own evil ways and your doings.
And your doings.
That were not good. And shall loathe yourself in your own sight.
And shall loathe yourself in your what?
Own sight.
In your own sight. You're going to loathe you. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm talking about, people, what I'm going through.
Yeah.
Read.
For your iniquities and for your abomination.
Wait a minute. You have iniquities and abomination? Mm. And now you righteous? Mm. No. Once you see your iniquities and your atrocities and all those things, right. You just stop doing them. Yeah. They just instantaneously, see, all you gotta do is accept the purpose. Mm-hmm. You can't tell them how to run. It's already been done. What I'm saying is, once you accept it, a weight comes off your mind. Mm-hmm. You know? Then there was people that I didn't care for. And then once you start something, man, I was just happy to see them because it was through that person that led me to know that y'all would use that vessel mm-hmm. to show me. Mm-hmm. So why am I going to get mad at the vessel? Mm-hmm. That's a trip on. Read this a little bit more.
Not for your sakes do I do this, saith Yahweh. Be it known unto you, be ashamed and confounded for your own ways, O house of Israel. Thus saith Yahweh. In the day that I shall have cleansed you from all your iniquities, I will also cause you to dwell in the cities, and the waste shall be builded.
Okay, go to Romans 1:19 and 20. But start at 21. Everybody 21. Know what Romans 1:19 and 20 is, right?
Right.
And here we're going to start at 21.
21.
I was told that, I don't know what the hell I was talking about. Okay. Till I read the lecture by the family, he backs me up every time. Mm-hmm. Romans 1:21.
Because that when they knew Yahweh.
Now hold it right there. Mm-hmm. These children of Israel down here in Egypt, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Yahweh, they saw Yahweh, Elohim pour out how many plagues?
Ten
devastating plagues. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
When it was when it was darkness in Egypt, it was light in Goshen.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So they had to go through a three-day journey to the Red Sea, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now they was living this. They looking right at it.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Then they saw that Red Sea heap into a tunnel-like effect, right? Mm-hmm. And walk through on dry ground, right? They saw this. After they knew, they knew him.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying? Because he was with them.
Right.
Yeah.
You understand? They go out here in the wilderness.
Right.
40 years of, he said, I had to deal with you out there and your manners or something like that for 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, then he put up with them. Okay? They saw this phenomenal fire on top of Mount Sinai.
Yeah.
They saw Moses come down and go back up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they saw this golden calf. You know, they saw what Yahweh did to those that worshiped the golden calf. Everything up in this wilderness that happened, they saw it. Read that.
Because that when they knew Yahweh, they glorified him not as Elohim, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened.
Yeah, when they came up on this mountain and they saw Elohim, and did eat and drink, and they came back down there, what did they go down there and build?
Golden
so they saw, they didn't see Elohim there. They're letting you know, they didn't see him for who he really was.
Yeah, right.
They said, build us this upcame mission. They said, this be the Elohim
that
brought us up out of Egypt. Now they saw that. Mm. They lived it. They experienced it. Just like we have since we've been in this school. The death, burial, resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. The blood, water, spirit, 40. Is that right?
That's right.
Read, man.
Professing himself to be wise, they became fool.
Ain't that what's going on in IDMR now?
That's right.
90% of the people in IDMR worship that man.
Mm-hmm.
It's all over. You can go to classes in other places. You won't have a class. You'll sit down there and watch you a DVD of three men.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? After they knew Yahweh manifested in a physical body, H.C. Kelly, they glorified him not but became vain in their imaginations. Read.
And changed the glory of the uncorruptible Elohim into an image made like to corruptible man and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things.
Right? Corruptible man? See what I'm
saying? Yeah.
That's what they changed him into.
That's right.
A corruptible reed.
Wherefore Yahweh also gave them up to uncleanness and through the lust of their own heart.
So Yahweh gave them up to the uncleanness of their heart. Read.
To dishonor their own bodies between themselves.
Read.
Who changed the truth of Yahweh into a lie.
Who changed the truth. Tell me that's not happening.
That's right. That's right.
We ought to be thankful for this school.
Yeah.
It's more clarity here than in other places.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
And worship and serve the creature rather than the creator.
They worship and serve the creature rather than the creator. Now, is that true or not?
Oh, man, right on the money.
Read.
Who is blessed forever.
Yeah.
Read.
For this cause Yahweh gave them up until vile afflictions, for their own women did change the natural use into that which is against nature.
Now, I read that scripture over in Pomona and mm-hmm. got cut up, beat up, thrown out. Read.
And likewise also the men having the natural use of the woman burned in their lust one toward another, men with men doing that which is indecent and receiving in themselves the recompense of their own errors, which was proper.
Read.
And even as they did not like to retain Yahweh in their knowledge, Yahweh gave them over to a reprobate mind.
Hallelujah.
To do those things which are not proper.
Now I'm going to say this, and I got to find a lecture, all these lectures. The founder said, somebody came to him, and they asked him about being a homosexual. He said, don't ever come to me with this, I'm so tired of hearing it.
Hmm.
He said, it just goes against the purpose. He says as simple as he put it. He said you can go to hell for it too. That's what the founder said.
Hmm.
You can look in Soul Quotes, and there's another one where he says it. He said you can go to hell for that. He said two men together or two women is not gonna produce life. Hmm. It goes against the purpose. Yahweh say be fruitful and multiply.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's what he meant by they're going against it, because he gave them over to the lust in their mind for the flesh. You know,
You know, just like it's always said on the floor, Yahweh show you so many things at one time, you just go, and? Mm-hmm. All you can do is just too much. Mm-hmm. I'm going to let somebody get up here. I'm going to sit down, but I want to get one more scripture.
I got a question. I agree with everything you want to say. We say a lot of things that Dr. Kinley said, and I just wondered why he allowed so many homosexuals to be around him in his, what you would call his upper echelon.
Yeah, like Dennis.
That wasn't the only one. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, it was plenty of them.
Yeah, well, whoever.
Even the guy that prepared his body after he died, he was a homosexual.
Yeah, but
there was a whole lot of them
that
he knew that they were homosexual.
Yes.
Wasn't just Dennis, yeah.
I know a whole bunch of them, and I love being around them too.
Yeah.
You know, but it still goes against the purpose.
I mean, it might go against the purpose. How can you say a person's going to go to hell when, what hell are you talking about going to?
You can be in hell right now.
I know.
What I'm saying is, if I preach to you and I prove something,
uh-huh.
but you say, I don't want to hear it, and you go about your way, that's how you can go to hell.
Because
he was told. He told everybody.
So what I'm saying, you can be a homosexual in this school and be saved.
Yeah, but you would no longer probably be old. I know two sisters that came in class about 30 years ago,
uh-huh.
and they was loving each other, very loving to uh-huh. each other. And one of them came up to me one day and said, Hamza, you know, we're not doing that no more. And I said, well, why? You know, she said, because this teaching is more important to us, and we don't want to lose our souls. So she was so showed something, but she didn't express it all to me.
Mm-hmm.
She just said that her and her friend are just going to be friends now. They're not going to be physical.
See, because when I read about homosexuality in his textbook,
yeah.
he talks different. He says he feels sorry for that person. See, I read an article years ago in Times Magazine, in the Times newspaper, of this doctor that did autopsies on homosexual men.
Mm-hmm.
And all these homosexual men that he did autopsies on, he said something in their brain was bigger than what it was in a normal man's brain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you told me.
So
that
how can we, if somebody's born like that, then you putting judgment on that? I'll judge no man for what he is. He can be a homosexual, a lesbian. It don't matter. Just don't mess with me. I like women.
Okay.
See?
I'm just sharing with you what the founder said.
But did you hear him say that or were you told that?
I got a lecture of what he says. And plus it's in the soul quotes.
Mm-hmm.
You got the soul quotes?
No, I don't have that. Don't.
Okay, I'll get you one. You can read what he said?
Because I know he would say something to one person. And he'll say that opposite to another person, depending on where your mind is.
I understand.
But that's all I'm saying. I was shocked.
But here's what I'm saying. There is a satanic spirit manifested in homosexuals and everybody
else. Everybody else,
What I'm saying is, if the truth comes to you, Reggie, do you still do smoke crack?
No, I don't smoke crack.
Okay, then, what I'm saying is that if Satan is in them, you know, and mm-hmm. they're not going to hear the truth anyway. They're going to keep going on with their pernicious ways. I'm not talking about everybody.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm saying is what he said. He said it goes against Yahweh's purpose.
Oh, I know. I understand what you're saying. Yeah.
But that question.
Because I heard Joe say the same thing too. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, but I'm going to get you some proof of it. I'm going to get you a couple lectures. And, you don't have a soul code, I get that too.
Okay.
You know, then you can read it for yourself because I had a hard time reading it too because my sister was.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't now. You know, there's a lot of things that the founder said that I didn't understand.
Mm-hmm.
He could have said blue and that blew my mind. Mm-hmm. You understand mm-hmm. what I'm saying? So I haven't attained and I'm trying to understand what I need to understand. Mm-hmm. But if I'm going to make a statement, I should be able to bring some kind of certification of that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I'll do. Because I'm not trying to get nobody upset.
And I understand that, yeah.
Uh-huh. But he was hard on Dennis.
Mm-hmm.
He wasn't that easy as you think he was.
Mm-hmm. But see, because that means if a person is gay, then
no, then he put
they wouldn't want to come in here.
He put Dennis with him to teach him. Mm-hmm. And Dennis made his choice.
Mm-hmm.
That's that simple.
But I mean, now, I ain't even talking about Dennis. That was Dennis. I mean, it was Durham and
That's
I mean, other big ones in L.A., you know, that was with him all the time.
He knew
exactly that what only thing Dennis ever told us is he asked Dr. Kelly to take it away from him.
Yeah, I
heard. And Dr. Kelly told him everybody's bothered with something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So nobody escapes.
To me, it's an addiction. Uh-uh. To me, it's an addiction. And the only ones we talk about in this country is alcohol and drugs. Mm-hmm. We don't get into the people that do anything for money, anything for sex,
mm-hmm.
up to the point where they will kill you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, rape a two-day-old baby.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, so you got addictions. But that's mm-hmm. carnality.
Oh,
that
yeah.
goes against the purpose.
Mm-hmm. Right, yeah.
You understand? But it's in the purpose.
Yeah, it goes against it, but it's in it.
Yeah, because you got an adversary.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
And he was given, this is his domain, mm-hmm. believe it or not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's why it's on the way out.
Mm-hmm.
It's down to the last, to the nitty gritty now. We're right in here. Right now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you can see that easily. But when I look at Yahweh and what he did to nations back here, when he told the children of Israel to go kill this nation, get kill that nation, tear up this nation and this
mm-hmm.
nation, that has to be manifested in this age, spiritually and psychologically. Somebody gotta be getting killed now. You know? Mm-hmm. But anyway, let me get this last scripture and somebody else can get up.
Okay.
So, 2 Corinthians 5:16.
5:16?
Yeah.
Corinthians 5:16. Okay. Wherefore, henceforth know we no man after the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
Yea, though we have known the Messiah after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. Therefore, if any man be in the Messiah, he is a new creature.
If any man be in the Messiah, he is a new creature.
Uh-huh.
Read.
He is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new.
Read.
And all things are of Yahweh, who has reconciled us to himself by Yahshua the Messiah, and have given authority to the ministry of reconciliation.
That's what this is, the ministry of reconciliation. We can right. reconcile the world. It's not a popularity contest.
Nope.
It's not a you the best this and you the best that. The Holy Spirit is a teacher and he's manifesting vessels, but we have a tendency to forget that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and Yahweh's not a respecter person.
Yeah.
And it's hard to tell somebody, just like it was hard to tell me my faults because I didn't want to hear them. But I'm not hard, mad about it no more. I know I was wrong for so many things that I have said about an individual. It's gonna get you. Gonna knees are gonna bow and your tongue is gonna confess. I'm telling you, Yahweh gonna kick you behind.
Mm-hmm.
It just ain't happened to you yet. A lot of us it hasn't happened to.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm telling you right now, I'd rather get it on this side of the flesh. What I need to get over to the other side when we take this thing off. I want peace of mind. That's all I seek now. I'm not worried about this body. I'm not going to go all the changes I went to trying to get it fixed and all that other stuff. As soon as I stopped trying to get it fixed, now it's starting to work better.
Mm-hmm.
Man. So you got to let Yahweh just do his thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And keep coming to class. Keep sharing this gospel. Mm-hmm. Don't give up no matter what it looks like in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Because we got something that they can never take away. We got something that is beyond anything they can... They being those that would be against it.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing they can do with this. They can't take this out of here.
That's right.
You understand? Right. Mm-hmm. You can kill his flesh, but you can't get rid of Yahweh, Elohim, Yahshua in here.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? So just give thanks, though it's only six of us in here. That's what it appears to be, physically.
Yeah.
But he said, where he get, where two or more gathered in my name, I'm there too. So this place is full, if I can say it like that.
Mm-hmm.
This is a blessed teaching, the best thing ever given to mankind.
That's right.
And with that, I say hallelujah. This is a stick right here.
Okay, if I call the next speaker. You know, John, when we learn, we have him here toward the illustrator, looking back to Moses, and he's just drawing out what he sees, the new heaven and earth, as it explained, you know, being drawn out, you know, the whole heaven has passed away.
That's right.
He's seen the new heaven being drawn out of the old.
Mm-hmm.
And
Say that again.
He's looking at the new heaven and earth being drawn out of the old.
Who are you talking about, John the Baptist?
John, the Apostle John, the last apostle.
Yeah, Revelator.
On the Isle of Patmos. See, we have it over here, all these, they call this a map chart?
Yeah.
He's way out here on the Aegean Sea, a little island.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah.
After all these nations, you know, Media, Persia, and all these,
mm-hmm.
all these conglomerations, you got pagan Rome, you got papal Rome.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and if you had it that all these the apostles, the rest of the apostolic fathers, those that were learning, they have to go confirm something. Well, they have to go see John that was out here in the Isle of Patmos. He was the last eyewitness.
Yeah.
To confirm, they have to go see John to confirm something about Yahshua the Messiah before he died. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So he's the one that seen, had a panoramic vision. That's why Dr. Kinley had this chart drawn. In Revelation, that's what the 21st chapter, that's what he's writing about.
Right.
Seeing the new heaven and earth, but he sees it being drawn out of the old.
Mm.
That's why it's described that way.
Yeah.
That's why he's just looking at Elohim.
Mm.
He sees all those jewels and everything.
Yeah.
It's all you just take time and look at it the way that it's written, and you'll see it. You know. That's just the way it is. But we're getting ready to go into the next stage. This age is spiritual. There's neither Greek, female. It's like it says. What's that one verse, Reggie, that says that we're neither female, male?
Neither male.
That's Romans
8. Yeah.
Romans.
I don't have it. Not Romans.
Yeah,
Kiwi
says muffled. That's what she said.
Oh,
she.
Okay.
Yeah.
He got it up there. You call it a scripture?
Yeah, where it says Romans, I think there's neither male, or female.
Which one is that, Joe, where it says there's neither male nor female? Is that
bond in? Bond nor free.
Yeah.
And bond in
Revelation?
First Corinthians 12:13.
First Corinthians 12:13.
I was reading down, and then I'll call the next speaker.
First Corinthians, okay. Mm-hmm. I got it right.
So we're in a spiritual age.
That's right.
You know. And there was a lecture I was reading that said, do you know the way to Chicago, the state of a man? And he talks about these ages, that they're come to an end, but not a complete end.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
And we have this over here, this chart here. The Messiah nailed these cardinal ordinances to the cross. All these laws, everything, I mean, we just got through talking about gays, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, we go back to Moses, right? What happened during the time? What did Moses write about? Sodom and Gomorrah, right?
Yeah.
What was happening back then?
Yeah.
With Lot.
Mm-hmm.
Wasn't that under the law?
I mean, you know, was that part of what Moses wrote about? Mm-hmm. What happened to that city? Got destroyed.
Yeah, sure.
Now, I know there was probably a law that was written about that. Mm-hmm. They had to take sacrifice to it. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe they got stoned or something. I haven't read about
that
it.
That was before the law.
They had to be nailed to the cross too, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Didn't Messiah have to die for that? But he died for that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now we're in a spiritual kingdom, right? So we don't, I mean, to me, and this is what we've been learning about, Yahshua in this vessel here,
mm-hmm.
okay? He's the one that's doing the work in these vessels, okay?
All along. Yeah.
This is our state and our condition. And we've been learning that Dr. Kenley, when he received this divine vision, revelation, he had to get rid of this,
mm-hmm.
this thing here,
mm-hmm.
before Yahweh showed him anything. He had to put, not him, but Yahshua had, Yahweh, I want to get rid of this thing, you know? So for him to see any, understand anything, you know, and that's what we have to do before we can understand anything. Let's understand him so he can write these things in our heart and mind.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, read that scripture, and then I'll call the next scripture.
12 and 13. Mm-hmm. 1 Corinthians 12 and 13. For by one Spirit are we all immersed into one body, whether we be Jews or Greek, whether we be bond or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many.
Mm-hmm.
If the foot shall say, because I'm not the hand, am That's I not of the body?
That's good enough there.
In Romans, Romans, I don't know whatever, 8 or 9 or whatever, it says that there are no Jews, no Gentile, no male, female.
Yeah, it's
female.
The same
thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Same one idea,
Romans,
you know. Yeah. So it's all a spiritual thing, you know.
Yeah.
Okay, our next speaker will be Dr. Samuel Salas. A few words of wisdom here.
Samuel.
There you go.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's always a privilege to stand before you and testify some of the things I learned in this school of IDMR. I've been attending classes for so long, but I didn't learn as much as the other people learn. And I, when I see another speaker in the floor, I see myself, the knowledge I have is like a nickel compared with $100 bill.
Mm-hmm.
But this is what the Yahweh showed me, mm-hmm. I can do nothing about. He gave us, for certain men, many revelations, and for another ones, only few, but those few are good enough because you know and learn what it's all about.
That's right.
That's the. I want to speak about something is in my mind. Number 7. We all say number 7 is, we can say, a Kabbalistic number. In another one way,
mm-hmm.
or we can say it's a prophetic number, and because it's mentioned in the Bible so many times, and with a meaning of that. Matter of fact, this man you see. Oh, this is a picture illustration about Yahshua the Messiah, who the world called Jesus Christ, he is the seven I am. The seven I am. He said, I am the bread of life. You can check in the Bible, and I am the light of the world. Number two, I am the door. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and life.
That's right.
I am the way, the truth, and the life. And I am the true vine. So he is the seven I am. It's all in all.
Yeah.
He is a creator. He is a savior. He is the one run all the purpose. This man, as you see in this illustration, is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit at the same time. That's a mystery. The mystery the world cannot see.
That's right.
Because they cannot understand how Yahweh explained them in the Bible, but they never have a time to look it up in the right direction. See, in the year 1931, a man have a vision and have a revelation after he had a vision. The vision, we all have a vision. I have a vision every day. Even in my dreams, I see something and next day I forget, or probably after I dream. And sometimes I see something, I think I look something, and it's not what I look, it's something else. We all have a vision. An engineer, a mathematics guy, or an inventor, they have a vision. Before they come up with whatever they have in their mind. So vision is not something out of a this world, this happened right now. I was talking about the man who had the vision. His name, Henry Clifford Kinley. The name is right here in this chart. Wheel. That man proved the vision he had.
That's right.
And he spent so many years trying to get across what he see. In the year 1931 to his death, 1976. He spent 45 years trying to get us understand how everything come up to came to exist, where we came from, and where we're going. That's the purpose of Yahweh. We can say it's a cycle of this creation. Everything God back to the source, the cloud, pure spirit. Spirit, the world have a problem to understand a spirit. Oh, this is a good spirit and a bad spirit. Yeah, how can they explain what a spirit is? the spirit is the makeup of man. Wrong or right, or right or wrong, that's the makeup. The original makeup of the man, when he born, are those nine principles attributes. And it's innocent, the baby, he has those attributes on him. But since he starts growing, those attributes are contaminated. Sometimes involuntarily, the fathers, they teach in a way that they are the ones corrupt the real ones. Oh, don't do this, don't do that. Because this and because that. But sometimes the parents do those things to protect the kid for the dangers in this world exist. But I'm going away from what I was really, really want to speak about. This is a mystery. It was a man we all know. His name was Moses. He was a goodly child. We all know his history about him. He was a baby, and Pharaoh, he wants to kill every children because the Hebrews, they start to multiplied in a big time. And they say, well, those people are really, really growing. In my day, one day they have another partners and defeat us, the Egyptians. We better do something to them, put them in bondage. But before that, before Moses appeared in Egypt, it was a man, his name was Joseph, who is the one bring everyone to his family to Egypt. They only were 70 people. Only 70 went over to Egypt. Of course, Joseph and his wife and his two sons, they were down there. But 70 is a number. You take the zero, it's a number 7. Mm-hmm. But he was so wise, Joseph, he became the right hand of Pharaoh.
That's right.
For what he did. It was Yahweh gave him a divine something he can reveal dreams, and he revealed Pharaoh's dreams, and he made him his right hand. So he was the second man in Egypt. Being that wise and rich, I can say. When his 7 folks came, his father and his brothers, he put them in the best place they can ever be. Mm-hmm. So he was powerful. He put them in Goshen, in the delta of the Nile River.
Goshen.
See, the Nile River started in the south, and Lake Victoria. It go all over north till they went into the Mediterranean Sea. All the topsoil, all the richness of the water of the river, they were right here. So that was the best land, a lot of food, a lot of animals to hunt. So they were doing very good. This is why they multiplied. in that manner. Mm-hmm. So I'm making the history a little short. Going back a little bit far, it was a man called Abraham. Abraham, he was chosen by Yahweh because he was a, in Yahweh's eye, he was a good man. And he was living in that time in a city called Ur, in Mesopotamia, right here, in the chart. It's two rivers coming this way, and between two rivers, they call a Mesopotamia. Tigris and the Euphrates. But those two rivers, they run the opposite way of the Nile River. Those rivers came from north to south, and the Egyptian Nile ran from south to north. Well, this is the geography. Abraham, he was a man from a descendant of the people living in the Babel, the Tower of Babel, or Babylonia. But when the people get confused, the language, they can understand each other, they spread everywhere, and he went to his father, Terah, went to Ur. So from there, he was told by Yahweh to go south. And Yahweh promised him a land. And one day, he will possess, and his descendants also. And he was 75 years old when he came out of Ur. He and his wife, Sarah. In that time was called Sarai. They went south with a nephew and went through the land of Canaan land. They passed through there. But Yahweh promised him from his seed, all the people will be blessed. But he was 90 years old, and his wife was a little bit younger. And normally, a person of 90 years and a woman of 80, it's hardly, it's not knowing a person have a children in that age, or can be so dangerous that mother cannot survive. But Sarai, the angel, told Abraham, excuse me, Sarai told his husband, Abraham, hey, I am too old. You have this woman,
Hagar,
as the concubine or the servant, and have a children with her, and I can claim it because she is mine. I can claim the baby is mine. So Abraham did so, they have a son called Ishmael. And Ishmael was about 12 or 13 years old when actually Sarah, because the name of Sarai was changed for Sarah, an angel appeared to Abraham and said, it's a time for you to, your wife, have a baby. "Oh, I'm too old. Don't worry." And his wife was listening in the tent, hiding, and she started laughing. "Oh, you're laughing because you're laughing. His name will be Isaac. That's the meaning. Mm-hmm. Who laugh." So, in a year, less than a year, she have a baby, and they call him Isaac. So when Sarah see Abraham loved Ishmael in the same way he loved Isaac, he got a little jealous. "Hey, why my son had to divide the wealth of my husband, Abraham?" "No, no, no. Hey, you put these women out of here. I don't want her here with his son. But it's my son. They cannot live with that." And an angel appeared to Abraham and said, "Don't worry. Mm-hmm. I will take care of him and take care of her too. Hey, give him something to eat and water and tell them to home." So they left, and actually, Ishmael, he is the father of many kingdoms and the Gentile land. All the Arab countries are descendants of Ishmael. But Isaac, he was the one, the real one, will carry the banner, we can say the banner of the Hebrews. Because Hebrew means the people came from the other side of the river.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So Isaac, also he himself, his wife have two sons, Jacob and Esau. Esau was the biggest, the older. They were twins, but the one born first was Esau. He was very husky, hairy, strong, and he liked to hunt. So he was very muscular. And Jacob, he was a little slender and not weak, but not with a skilled attribute of a hunter or a sportman. So, but Yahweh have a purpose with him. So he, one time, Esau went over to hunt. He come back. He was so hungry. He said, "Oh, why you make Jacob? Oh, I make this dish, lentils. Oh, give me some." "No, no, no, no. Please give me some." "No, I give you some, but you give me the profanity. How do you say it?
First right."
A birthright, because you are the oldest, you were supposed to be the leader after my father Abraham passed. "Okay, give me that lentils, and I give it to you." "What is, my stomach is hurt right now." So he forgot about that, what he did. Abraham was too old, and he was almost close to pass. He said, he told his wife, it was Rachel, no, Rachel, it was, what is his name of Isaac's wife, was Rebecca?
Yeah.
He said, "Bring my son because I want to anoint him, be the leader." And he said, "Oh, no, I said, in my anointing Esau, but no, I want him to anoint Jacob." And he make something from a goat, a little piece of skin, right here in his arm. Mm-hmm. And he have a coat with the smell of a hunter, because he was very strong. Whoever sweat a lot from hunting and doing sport things,
yeah,
he have a different smell, a sweat smell. So he put one of the coats of his son, Esau. He said, "Go and tell him." Tell Esau, he said, "Esau, go," he said before, "go and bring a dish, the ones I like, and I give you the right." Mm-hmm. And he went to hunt, but in that time, when he went to hunt for a deer or any animal, Rachel told Jacob, hey, what will your father? He will give you the right. Mm-hmm. And he put the skin, he put the coat, and hey, but my voice is not as my brother. He looked, he speak like, you know, thin. Mm-hmm. He said, oh, here I am, Father, bless me. I am your son, Esau. And he was blind. He said, oh, come close. He grabbed his arm and he said, oh, it's heavy, it's him. But why your voice is not as Esau? I am Esau. Oh, I probably have a little problem in my ears. And he said, come a little close, give me a kiss. When he was pleased, he grabbed it from the chest, from the shirt or the coat. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it smelled like Esau. He said, I see. So he blessed him right there.
Right.
Yeah. And he went away. And Esau came with a hand and fixed the dish his father Abraham likes. Father, I bring you the dish you asked me for. What? I already eat and bless you. Oh no, son. Oh, Jacob. He was so angry. He was ready to kill him. But Rebecca, the mother, told Jacob, take these belongings and run out of here. Go away. I have a relative, Laban, somewhere north, and go and live with him. So he escaped the dangers of Esau. So he went over there and he met a man, is one of his relatives, and he see a girl, Rachel. She was so beautiful, young girl. As soon as he see her, he wasn't feeling love. So he lived with him and he said, well, you're ready to, because start working with him, you're ready to choose from my daughters which one you like to. Yeah. I like to have a Rachel. Oh. Well, you don't have nothing, you broke, you poor. You have to work 7 years and that way you can accumulate a little bit of wealth and I give it here to you. You have to work 7 years. Okay, no problem. I worked 7 years and I married her. The 7 years went by. So he said, well, I worked 7 years for you. As you say, you gave me Rachel as a wife. Yeah. Hey, you guys, he told the servant, hey, kill some animals, make wine, and make everything ready for the marriage party of Rebecca and Jacob. Yeah. So, man, it was a big party, a lot of food and everything. He got drunk. Mm. When he was drunk, and they carried him. If he drinks so much and eats so much, and probably dance too, they carry him to the tent where his wife and he will be, spend the night. Mm-hmm. And but he was so drunk, and when he wake up in the morning and try to kiss her, his wife, he opened the bell and her face, and he see. The oldest sister, Leah. He said, oh, Laban tricked me. I want to marry Rebecca, not Leah. And he went so angry to his father-in-law. He said, hey, you tricked me. You lied to me. No, 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 no. According to the ways of my tribe, the oldest girl marry first.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
But if you want to marry Rachel, it's no problem. What do you mean? You can marry both. But you have to work another 7 years, and I give it to you. But this is the way the book says. And we sometimes come up with something, how that happened. And to me, they make another marriage right away and give the girl, Rachel, but he had to fulfill and work 7 years. Mm. But he cannot spend 14 years waiting for one wife. It might be too old here for have children. So he had two wives, Leah and Rachel. And Rachel cannot have, didn't have babies, and Leah, she every year, one, two, he had six, plus a girl.
Yeah.
She had six sons and one daughter. And Rachel, he have a little problem with give a birth to children. Finally, she asked Yahweh, and Yahweh blessed her with one son, Joseph. That's the Joseph I'm talking to you about. The one take all the his family to Egypt. So, and so she had only one son, but before she had one son, before that happened, Leah had one servant. And Rachel have another servant, a woman.
That's right.
And Rachel tell her servant, "Is this thing going? Is like normally in those Hebrew people, the tradition, the way they conduct themselves? Oh, you, Bila, sleep with my husband Jacob, and she have." If you have one son or one daughter, it will be mine. And she did so. And Bila sleep with Jacob, and she have one son. Leah, see that is, oh, hey, Zilpa sleep with Jacob, and your son will be mine. We have to be more than her sons. And Bila, Zilpa, have another boy. And he said, oh, Bila, sleep one more time. So actually, Bila have two sons, and Zilpa have another two sons, both of the servants' girls. But Rachel have one son, Joseph, and later on have another one, Benjamin. When she had Benjamin, she passed. He survived, but not her. But Rachel was buried and close to the city of Bethlehem. Let me put a map over here. The city of Bethlehem, it was right here, and Judah, when they give the land to the 12 tribes, the Judah was on the south side, and Benjamin was in the north side. Here is Jerusalem, right here, and Bethlehem, right here. Mm-hmm. This is why this, when Herod the Great say, kill all the Hebrews, he want to kill the baby, Yahshua. He said, oh, even Rachel is crying.
Mm-hmm. Weeping for a child.
Weeping for children. Mm-hmm. Why? Rachel was buried in the cemetery of Bethlehem, right in next. Right here. Now in Judah, Jerusalem was given to inheritance of Benjamin. Later on, when David became a king, he was king 7 years in Hebron. He was king right here. But he moved to Jerusalem to be his place for the kingdom of his palace will be. So also the Solomon Temple. Solomon Temple. It's in Jerusalem. But it was a Benjamin inheritance land, not a Judah land. This is so many things this school, we start thinking and looking into things never. See, Yahweh give a revelation to everyone. Mm-hmm. The other day, and I think before that, 16 messiahs came mm-hmm. before the last one, Yahshua the Messiah. Messiah means the ones were sent with a message, like Isaiah, Okay, Jeremiah was one of the prophets, mm-hmm. and all the prophets.
Where is the Bible?
Can you pick up where all the okay, I can get it.
Right here?
Yeah, let me get it. Thank you. See, the 16 messiahs, it was Isaiah, Jeremiah, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. Those are the 16. See, Yahweh, Elohim, he have a purpose for everyone. He sent them with a message to tell the people. Mm-hmm. Prophesy. Whoever give a prophesy is not the person. It's Yahweh's purpose through that person give the message. So they were messiahs. This was Yahweh send the Spirit through them to reveal what he have in mind. So those are the 16 before. But none of those before him died for nobody. The difference was this was the real one, or the Creator himself.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. He don't send no one, and from those mouths say things.
That's right.
He came personally.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And physically. So this is the last sacrifice. How can that be proved? Okay, if we have to prove that, we have to use this tabernacle pattern. Also, there is a 7 steps in this tabernacle. I could say like the number 7 is very important in this teaching or for spiritual meanings. The altar of sin sacrifice is 1 step. The brazen laver and the oil, and the second and third step, and the curtains are the four, the holy place, and the five, the veil, six, and the most holy place is the seven. Seven steps in the tabernacle. I didn't know those things. I just learned in this particular school of Ontario. And all the last beautiful revelation I have, this place is very special for me. I spent so many years in another school, and I didn't learn much. I was pressing for more accurate and explain, but nobody, only few people have the ability to do so. But here, we don't need so many. One or two, that's enough spirit. And because the reality is one. Me, myself, I'd better be sitting right there and learning. Yeah. Of course, I can say, well, I can learn when I say things, but I think I can learn more just sitting and listening.
That's right.
So I can tell you this is a beautiful place to be, and before I sit down, let me explain you about this tabernacle. Okay, I already explained you the seven steps. But right here, there is one high priest. This high priest, he go all the way up. It was in the Koran about high place and the holy place and the most holy place. 1, 2, 3. But the way he went in is very important, because it was a type and a shadow of, I can say this, Yahshua the Messiah.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
And the way you see him with clothes, and you see him is Yahshua the Messiah, naked, but he is with the clothes of beauty and glory. The way he's dressed up is something very special. This high priest, he have a white tunic, and he have a coat, blue, little dark blue. And the dark blue coat, he have one apple, like a coat of different colors, like a rainbow. Mm-hmm. Same as the coat of the one Joseph received from his father Jacob. The cloth was also like a rainbow, colorful. Then he have in his chest 12 stones. All the most beautiful stone, ruby, sapphire, emerald, topazio, diamond, onyx, etc., etc. But they were 12. Mm-hmm. And each one of the stone represent one of the tribes.
That's right.
They were put in a plate of gold, and each stone has the name of each tribe. I don't know how they did in the diamonds, but they were writing down in those stones the name of each tribe. Every stone represents one of the tribes of Israel. Now he have a girdle or belt. And the same color and the same material of the apple. The apple has gold and silver embroidered in a beautiful manner, especially. And it have a head called bonnet or turban. And on top of the shoulders, the high priest had two stones of onyx also, when six of the sons of Jacob on one side, and the other six on the other side. Those stones were put in gaskets of gold also. And the plate of gold with the stones, they have a chain connected to the six stones and the shoulder. And the head, the turban or bonnet, it was a gold crown. That gold crown have a word inscribed in there, and the gold crown say holiness to Yahweh. That was inscribed in the crown. And when he went in there, he don't have no shoes on him. Barefoot. Why? Because he had to wash his feet in here and in the place in there before entering into the door. He had to wash his hands and his feet. And he had to be clean before going into the holy place. This is why I say he don't have no shoes. Because this man, who in reality was a real high priest, he didn't have no shoes when he was crucified. In there. This high priest he had to kill an ox. That sacrifice was for him to clean himself. That sacrifice of an ox can be 5, can be 10, can be 20, or 1 year old. No problem. Because an ox cannot have a relation with no cow. It was pure, with no contact. And when they sacrifice the goats and the lamb, have to be before 1 year old, before they have a relation with another goat. Because they don't have to have a spot and blemish. This is the lamb, the real lamb, who was sacrificed for the sins of the world. The real one, the one who was a type and a shadow, was right here sacrificed, but also had to be without spot and blemish. There were 3 sacrifices during the day, and the day of the atonement, once a year. The first sacrifice was for cleansing him of the high priest. The second was for the cleansing of the tabernacle, and the last one was for the, how can I say, for the people. Mm-hmm. For the sin of the people.
Yeah.
That was the lamb sacrificed and the last. The last sacrifice was not the lamb. It was the real lamb.
The true lamb. Yeah.
Now, that lamb, it was sacrificed long before, right here. He was, oh, he is the lamb, the real lamb, but is manifest, and he is manifest, visible and physical. Yahweh, El Yahweh, and his pure spirit, it's hard to wait to explain this. It cannot, nobody seen the Father at any time.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So you cannot see Yahweh, but you can see the Son, the Lamb, Elohim, in a visions and in a revelations. Mm-hmm. Going a little bit more far, this Lamb came 4,000 years later, according to Moses' vision, mm-hmm. because Moses had a vision of how the creation became to exist, but in reality, this lamb is ever, forever. And the spiritual creation, it became to exist in the spiritual creation. Then is the Father of the physical creation. Everything came to exist from Elohim. Mm-hmm. As everybody say, after the Son of Yahweh became to exist, Yahweh went out of business. Mm-hmm. His Son do the whole thing. Elohim is the only title of Yahweh, a divine title of Yahweh, who is chosen by himself. Therefore, according to Moses' vision, the fourth day, the sun was placed in the universe, and the stars and the moons and the planets, mm-hmm. representing the 4,000 years, the real sun, it will appear into men. Yahshua, mm-hmm. the Messiah. When he was crucified, it was late in the afternoon, 6 o'clock, when the sun was on its way down. Same spirit in the 4,000 years. According to Moses' vision, the sun and Adam and Eve. It's not time for that. But it's, what is next is very important. Adam also was the type of Elohim. He came down out of the beautiful garden and stayed. Well, next time, I don't have even to touch that part of this explanation, because that takes a long and a good, have to be explained real good. It's for another occasion. Well, excuse my way of pronunciation and my I don't have all the words in English, but I try to do my best. And thank you very much for having the patience to listen to me. And thank you very much, and have a good night.
Okay, that concludes tonight's lectures. Are there any announcements? Joe, I guess he'll be leaving this weekend, right?
Right.
To the Chicago
convention.
Convention.
Yes.
We're still going to have class later Sunday, right? Okay. Okay, we have classes here Sundays, 11 to 1. Tuesdays and Fridays, 7:30 to 9:30. So I'll stand be dismissed. All the nations can be had by Dr. Lloyd Lawless. Okay. Now to him that is able to keep from falling, present you falling with presence with exceeding joy. And otherwise, I'll him our Savior, through Yahshua Sarah, sovereign, be like glory, dominion, and power, for all time, now and ever. Let's all say,
Hallelujah.